Welcome to worship with Mount Olive Lutheran Church. I'm Lisa Janke, one of the pastors at Mount Olive. Whether this is your first time with us or you've been worshiping with us for a while, we are so grateful to have you. Our prelude will begin shortly, and we invite you, as always, to prepare yourself for worship. You may wish to light a candle and grab some bread or crackers, wine or juice for communion, which we will celebrate together later in the service. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from generation to generation. Amen. Trusting in the mercy of God, let us confess our sin. Reconciling God, we confess that we do not trust your abundance, and we deny your presence in our lives. We place our hope in ourselves and rely on our own efforts. We fail to believe that you provide enough for all. We abuse your good creation for our own benefit. We fear difference and do not welcome others as you have welcomed us. We sin in thought, word, and deed. By your grace, forgive us. Through your love, renew us. And in your spirit, lead us, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Amen. Beloved of God, by the radical abundance of divine mercy, we have peace with God through Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained grace upon grace. Our sins are forgiven. Let us now live in hope. For hope does not disappoint, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. God's will is done. the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for planting in us the seed of your word. By your Holy Spirit, help us to receive it with joy, live according to it, and grow in faith and hope and love. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
A reading from Genesis. These are the descendants of Isaac, Abraham's son. Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac was 40 years old when he married Rebekah, daughter of Bethuel the Aramean of Paddan Aram, sister of Laban the Aramean. Isaac prayed to the Lord for his wife because she was barren, and the Lord granted his prayer, and his wife Rebekah conceived. The children struggled together within her, and she said, "If it is to be this way, why do I live?" So she went to inquire of the Lord, and the Lord said to her, "Two nations are in your womb, and two people born of you shall be divided. The one shall be stronger than the other. The elder shall serve the younger." When her time to give birth was at hand, there were twins in her womb. The first came out red, all his body like a hairy mantle, so they named him Esau. Afterward, his brother came out, with his hand gripping Esau's heel, so he was named Jacob. Isaac was 60 years old when she bore them. When the boys grew up, Esau was a skillful hunter, a man of the field, while Jacob was a quiet man, living in tents. Isaac loved Esau because he was fond of game, but Rebekah loved Jacob. Once when Jacob was cooking a stew, Esau came in from the field, and he was famished. Esau said to Jacob, "Let me eat some of that red stuff, for I am famished." Therefore, he was called Edom. Jacob said, "First, sell me your birthright." Esau said, "I am about to die. Of what use is a birthright to me?" Jacob said, "Swear to me first." So he swore to him and sold his birthright to Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and lentil stew, and he ate and drank and rose and went his way. Thus Esau despised his birthright. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
Psalm 119 is the longest of all the 150 Psalms. The psalmist went way overboard here on this one to celebrate the way of God, God's Torah in Hebrew. There are 22 stanzas of 8 verses each. It is rich. It is a little obsessive even. And you could say the tone of Psalm 119 is mostly lament. But when life is hard, God's way is still present with us. And every once in a while, we have a moment of praise and thanksgiving and gratitude. Like today, our song today is "You Are a Light on My Path." I'll sing it a couple times so you know what your part is. What clarity are you looking for in your life right now? You are a light on my path, shining for the world, showing the way, leading on. You are a light on my path, shining for the world, showing the way, leading on. You are a light on my path. That's your part. Listen again. You are a light on my path, shining for the world, showing the way, leading on. You are a light on my path, shining for the world, showing the way, leading on. You are a light on my path. Let's try it together. You are a light on my path, shining for the world, showing the way, leading on. You are a light on my path, shining for the world, showing the way, leading on. You are a light on my path.
I got a verse.
Teach us your way, give us your life, smile at the praise we bring. Teach us your way, give us your life, smile at the praise we bring.
Here we go.
You are a light on my path, shining for the world, showing the way, leading on. You are a light on my path, shining for the world, showing the way, leading on. You are a light on my path.
My turn.
Even in fear, we will not stray. You are our history. Even in fear, we will not stray. You are our history.
Here we go.
You are a light in my path, shining for the world, showing the way, leading on. You are a light in my path, shining for the world, showing the way, leading on. You are a light in my path. I am resolved to follow you. You are my heart's delight. I am resolved to follow you. You are my heart's delight.
Yeah.
You are a light in my path, shining for the world, showing the way, leading on. You are a light in my path, shining for the world, showing the way, leading on.
Yeah.
You are a light in my path, shining for the world, showing the way, leading on. You are a light on my path, shining for the world, showing the way, leading on. You are a light on my path.
Ooh. Hey kids, Travis here. Pop quiz time. Do you know what this plant is? That's right, it's a dandelion. It's kind of a funny word. It means lion's teeth, because the leaves look like rows of big teeth. We often call dandelions weed, because for some reason we like our lawns to be a big solid patch of grass without other pesky plants growing up in it. But dandelions can easily take over a lawn. They grow fast and spread fast. A single flower can hold 100 or more seeds. And in just 2 months, one flower can become 100 new flowers, each with 100 or more seeds of its own. And in 2 more months, those 100 flowers can become 10,000 flowers. That's one of the things that fascinates me about how nature works. We as human beings, when we plant things, we like to prepare the soil, we buy special potting soil or potting mix, and we pick a spot where we want the plants to grow, considering if it's got the right amount of sun or shade, and then we water it when it's thirsty. But nature on its own doesn't work that way. Plants can't buy special soil or clear the rocks or water themselves. They need the wind and animals to help them plant new seeds. And since some of those seeds might not make it, a plant can't always afford to get by with just a few seeds. So some plants, like dandelions, make as many seeds as possible so that hopefully some will land in good soil. In a little bit, we're going to hear Jesus tell a story about a gardener who does the same thing. Instead of taking the time to prepare the soil, to plant the seeds where the gardener has made a place for them to grow, the gardener in this story is going to scatter seed everywhere. Some of those seeds are going to make it and some won't. I want you to think of words like those seeds. Something as simple as telling someone that you like their shirt or you like their hair. Comforting someone if they're feeling blue. Be generous with those seeds, because you might help make that person's day a little bit better. Or maybe it's something more serious, like telling an adult when someone hurts you or makes you feel afraid or unsafe. Sometimes, as adults, we fail to listen when you tell us your fears or concerns. And that's our fault, not yours. So don't give up. Keep planting those seeds, those words that tell us your feelings, until we listen or until you find an adult who does listen. Words that help and words that heal are so important these days. So be generous with those seeds, and you can help make the world a better place. Thanks, kids. Have a good week.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the lake. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Let anyone with ears listen." Then the disciples came and asked him, "Why do you speak to them in parables?" He answered, "To you it has been given to know the secrets of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it has not been given. For to those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. The reason I speak to them in parables is that seeing they do not perceive, and hearing they do not listen, nor do they understand. With them indeed is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah that says, 'You will indeed listen but never understand, and you will indeed look but never perceive. For this people's heart has grown dull, and their ears are hard of hearing, and they have shut their eyes so that they might not look with their eyes and listen with their ears and understand with their heart and turn, and I would heal them. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. Truly I tell you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see what you see, but did not see it, and to hear what you hear, but did not hear it. Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a while. And when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Several years ago, Sam and I saw REO Speedwagon in concert at the Surf Ballroom in Clear Lake, Iowa. While we were waiting for the concert to start, we struck up a conversation with the woman in the booth next to us. We learned that she was single, having been divorced from her ex-husband. But that had been several years ago, and she said she was over him now. As the conversation continued, she wound up doing most of the talking and reminded us several times how over her ex she was. After the concert, Sam and I chatted about this amusing interaction that we'd had with this woman. Clearly, she was trying to prove just how over her ex she was, but it wasn't clear just who she was trying to convince, us or herself. And so we concluded that one of life's lessons is that if you feel the need to tell other people how well you've moved on, you probably haven't. Or as my uncle once told my aunt when she got on a soapbox about something that had happened a decade before, it's nice to see that after all these years, you've let that go. Recently, I found a great story that illustrates this. Two Zen monks, Tenzan and Akito, were traveling down a country road, which was coated with mud after heavy rains. As they approached a village, they encountered a woman who was trying to cross from one side of the road to the other, but the mud was so thick that she would have ruined the silk kimono she was wearing. As they approached, Tenzan said to her, "Come here." And lifting her up in his arms, he carried her to the other side of the road. The two monks then continued their journey in silence. And when they reached their destination for the night, Akito could no longer restrain himself, and he confronted Tenzan. "Why did you carry that woman across the road? As monks, we are not supposed to go near females, especially lovely ones. It's dangerous. Why did you do that?" And Tenzan replied, "I put the woman down hours ago. Are you still carrying her?" Today, we are talking about the power of stories, especially parables. Jesus uses parables a lot in his teaching. And in today's gospel reading, the disciples want to know why. And so Jesus explains that parables are a tool for sifting the audience, separating those who perceive from those who do not perceive. David McCracken writes about this in his book, The Scandal of the Gospels. He says, "Parables do not contain knowledge. They cannot be understood as we understand a moral tale, an argument, or a statement. Parables precipitate internal action, forcing the hearer or reader to a crisis or collision that requires movement, which in New Testament terms is an either-or, either stumbling or changing and becoming, either enacting a lie that we desire or being transformed." I love McCracken's use of the word crisis in this quote. The great Greek and Roman physicians Hippocrates and Galen used the word crisis to describe the moment in the progression of an illness when the physician would know whether the patient was going to make it or not. A turning point when either the body's healing forces would win over the disease or whether the disease would win and the patient would succumb. The role of the parable as a teaching tool is to induce a similar crisis in the hearer, a decisive moment of understanding and action, so that if you choose to engage with the parable, you are forced down one of two paths. On the one hand, the parable can open up new avenues of inquiry, illuminate blind spots you didn't know you had, or work to dismantle your current outdated view of the world and help you rebuild a new one. Or on the other hand, it can serve to reinforce what you already think, tempting you to root yourself even more deeply into your biases, preconceptions, or misconceptions. This is why Jesus says that for those who have understanding, they will have even more understanding and have it abundantly. But for those who lack understanding, even what tiny nuggets of understanding they do have will be taken away. This kind of decisive crisis seems to be happening with all of us these days. We are all stumbling and struggling our way in this society through yet another conversation about white supremacy and racism, the essence of which pervades our culture like the air we breathe. Sam and I, in conversations online or in person, are working on cultivating our own anti-racism, trying to resist allowing racist statements to go unchallenged. The other day, Sam was commenting back and forth with someone online and doing an incredible job of being patient and just asking questions. As she and I debriefed later about this interaction she was having, we talked about the importance of resisting the temptation to go into a conversation like that in attack mode, lobbing verbal grenades at your opponent, which only serves to trigger their defensiveness, and they won't hear anything you say. Now, going in with a more patient, curiosity-focused approach is no guarantee that they won't get defensive anyway, but it at least allows for the possibility. And it accomplishes a thing similar to what Jesus' parables do. The questions demand that the person choose between doubling down on their position and revealing their unconscious or conscious commitment to racism, or they may gain new insight into their own thoughts, feelings, and behaviors. And even in the midst of their defensiveness, that conversation can sow seeds that later on will bloom into a new worldview. Parables are even more powerful than questions for creating these crisis moments. Because while questions can create dialogue, stories can create experiences. Stories activate our senses, trigger our imaginations, get us to identify with characters. They can build visions of futures that we never before thought were possible. By wrapping truth in story, Jesus invites us not only into an intellectual struggle with the content of the story, but into an emotional struggle as well, and invites us to be changed as a result. But the problem is that, as Peter Senge puts it, people don't resist change, they resist being changed. And that's precisely the trap of the parable. To struggle and stumble our way through shame and vulnerability into a new truth, or to defend our old truth and allow fear to lock us into a prison of the familiar and the comfortable. So what new truths can this parable of the sower teach us today? Probably the most common way of approaching this story is to see God as the sower and us as the different types of soil. And I could have easily picked the song, "Lord, Let My Heart Be Good Soil," to help us unpack that. But you may have already noticed the seeds that I've been planting for how I want to approach this text today. Given our current climate of speaking truth to power and naming racial injustices, I want to imagine us as the sower and the seeds as words of healing and liberation to set the captive free. And by captive, I don't just mean the victims of oppression, but also those of us who are the oppressors, who are trapped in those cycles of ongoing violence against those victims, both by what we have done and by what we have left undone. In Lutheran language, we might call these conversations mutual conversation and consolation, something Luther considered to be such holy work that he put it alongside baptism and communion as one of the places where God in Christ promises to show up and meet us. As Jesus says, "Wherever two or three are gathered in my name, there I am in the midst of them." These are dialogues that seek to plant seeds of reconciliation in the rocky soil of broken relationships. Seeds of healing and wholeness in parched hearts and minds, dried up in the absence of love and connection and belonging. Seeds to grow beyond the thorns and brambles of oppression and soak in the abundant sunshine of freedom and liberation. But enough about the seeds. What do we know about the sower in the parable? The sower in the parable scatters seeds everywhere, unconcerned with how much of that seed may be lost to birds or rocks or thorns. It is tempting for us to not speak up or call out bad behavior. Ah, they won't listen to me anyway. What good would it do? It is tempting to not give to the homeless out of our suspicion that they may use our dollars to buy drugs or alcohol. But that's letting others' behavior determine ours. So perhaps this parable's truth for our time is that we should be generous with those seeds. To be generous with seeds of truth, even if others may not be listening. Because somewhere those seeds may take root and justice and peace will bloom. To be generous with seeds of compassion, even when we think others don't deserve it. Because somewhere those seeds may take root and ease their suffering in this world. We should be generous with seeds of truth and compassion, regardless of whether we think it's worth it. Because what others choose to do with those seeds is a reflection of their character. But to see injustice and suffering and to not sow seeds of truth and compassion is a reflection of ours. A final thought. From the Bible's perspective, tending gardens that are full of thorns and thistles is the essence of the human condition. God places humanity in the garden and says, tend it and keep it. And then when we as humanity chose to eat from the fruit of the tree we were commanded not to seize knowledge of good and evil, moral decision-making for ourselves, God says, cursed is the ground. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth. By the sweat of your face shall you eat bread. A gardener takes the soil as it is, not as they want it to be. Faced with bad soil, a gardener knows what to do. Add organic matter, fertilizer, compost. And so at the risk of stretching this parable way beyond what it was designed for, the seeds those birds eat later become fertilizer. The plants that sprout and then die and the seeds that never sprout at all become compost. All of it transforming bad soil into good soil. No matter what the soil is, the sower in the parable just keeps sowing. What others might see as failure is merely the slow and steady transformation of barren soil into fertile ground for abundant life. So keep sowing seeds of truth and compassion and tend the garden. Amen.
Strong foundation, lead us to
called into unity with one another and the whole creation, let us pray for our shared world, saying, "Hear us, O God," and responding, "Your mercy is great." Creating God, the mountains and hills burst into song, and the trees and fields clap their hands in praise. We pray for the birds and animals who make their home in the trees, and for lands stripped bare by deforestation. Empower us to sustainably use what you have given. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Reigning God, we pray for our nation's leaders. Increase their desire for justice and equality. We pray for our enemies. Bridge the chasms that divide us and guide authorities to a deep and lasting peace. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Abiding God, care for all who are in need, especially Mount Olive members and friends who are ill, grieving, or recovering from surgery. Those sick, recovering, anxious, homebound, or grieving because of COVID-19. All who are experiencing job loss, reduction of employment, or financial instability. All who are entering or continuing the hard work of confronting institutional racism in ourselves and our society, and all those who live with the effects of racism in their daily lives. All homebound members. For those who are doubting, renew faith. For those who are worrying, provide release. For those who are struggling, ease burdens. For those in fear, give hope. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Renewing God, revive your church in this place. Nourish and nurture the seeds you have planted that we might grow as disciples. Replace what has been depleted. Sustain all our ministries, especially our companions in ministry in Quijota, Tanzania, and Bogota, Colombia. May God's welcome come to them and through them that all might be blessed, and may all our efforts deepen relationships with the wider community. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Eternal God, we give thanks for all in our cloud of witnesses, especially Nathan Soderblom, Bishop of Uppsala, whom we commemorate today. Comfort us in the sure and certain hope of the resurrection. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Receive these prayers, O God, and those too deep for words, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always, and also with you. Please share words of God's peace with one another.
Let us pray. God of goodness and growth, all creation is yours, and your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. Water and word, wine and bread, these are signs of your abundant grace. Nourish us through these gifts, that we might proclaim your steadfast love in our communities and in the world, through Jesus Christ, our strength and our song.
Amen.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Gathered at the Lord's table and around our own, we remember with thanksgiving that in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. With your holy ones of all times and places, with the earth and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars, we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your love and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Friends of Jesus, come to the table. Receive nourishment for your journey. For those of you who are celebrating communion together, please share the bread and the cup, saying, "The body of Christ given for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you." For those of you who are communing on your own, please take the bread. "This is the body of Christ given for you." And take the cup. "This is the blood of Christ shed for you." Thanks be to God. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and preserve you in his grace. Amen. Amen. God of the welcome table, in this meal we have feasted on your goodness and have been united by your presence among us. Empower us to go forth sustained by these gifts so that we may share your neighborly love with all. Through Jesus Christ, the giver of abundant life. Amen. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. God the Creator, Jesus the Christ, and the Holy Spirit the Comforter bless you and keep you in eternal love. Amen. Peace. Christ is with you. Thanks be to God.